Closed captioning for News 12 is brought to you by Kenneth Nugent. From the station that's on your side, this is News 12 at 6 o'clock.
Today, a local family should be celebrating their little boy's 11th birthday. Instead, they're doing their best to remember him as they wait for an answer after a deadly house fire.
Me and my son stay together. When we sleep together, he hold me. He say, "Daddy, I love you." And I hold him. I let him sleep. I let him how he say, "Good night, Daddy."
Heartbreaking to hear, but friends released balloons in his memory at a South Columbia elementary school. This happened just a few minutes ago, and that's where Nicholas was finishing his fourth grade year this year. You also just heard his father, understandably emotional, speaking with us about one of his favorite memories with his son.
Our Will Rio has been covering the story the past 2 days, says this is one of the hardest stories he's ever had to cover. And when he was at the house yesterday, Nicholas May's father, Tony, as you just heard from, he showed up and he sent us some pictures. He wanted his son to be remembered for the amazing boy he was. Nicholas's favorite color was purple. Here's Will with some more from the family as they remember Nicholas on his 11th birthday.
At 214 Sarah Creek Court, the house, the memories are gone. The only thing left is a family in pain looking for answers.
Me and my son stay together.
Tony Mai is Nicholas's father. You could feel the pain in his voice as he shared pictures and memories of his little boy.
I feel very bad. I'm hurt. Yesterday and today, I cannot sleep. When I close my eyes, I see all my son burn.
His dad tells me he had just finished the fourth grade at South Columbia Elementary School. He was on the honor roll and at the top of his class.
My son very honored. He's very friendly with everybody in school and neighborhood.
An incident report details what deputies did when they got to the home. It was too engulfed for officers to go in, but deputies did go in to two houses next door.
3:30, she called me. She said, "My son died." I said, "Why?" She said, "Died in my house, in her house. Her house burned fire." I said, "Where are you now?" She said, "He's outside."
Outside, as their son was stuck inside the home.
Nobody come in. Nobody come in to pick up my son.
In tears, this is what he says he'll miss the most.
"Daddy, Daddy, I love you. Anyway, when we sleep together, he hold me. He said, 'Daddy, I love you.' And I hold him. I love him."
Our hearts just going out of that family as they begin the grief process. And we did speak with Tony about what he was told by officials, and he says the fire report could take 3 to 4 days to get a hold of, but we're continuing to try to get our hands on that to find out what could have caused this fire, what led up to this, but we'll keep you posted as soon as we find out. Well, as we go through the report, we are going to be seeing more storms for tomorrow. We'll talk about that coming up in about 10 minutes, guys.
Thank you, Anthony. There's plenty of buzz and doubt around the city over plans to redevelop the old Regency Mall. A lot of you are skeptical with these plans falling through several times over the years.
But the architect helping with the project for a new restaurant, housing, and shop says this time plans will follow through. Our Kennedy Harris spent the day finding out how it could change the face of South Augusta.
Remember when we told you they first started demolition back in October of 2020? They knocked down a wall, and it's been like that for months. And now we know why. That part of the mall started to fail, so owners tore it down. But the rest is solid, and it'll be used as part of this big plan.
I always wonder what it was like inside. I heard great stories.
For decades, it's been an empty reminder of the past. Now some see it as the glimmer of growth for a forgotten part of town.
Around that area and Gordon Highway, I saw a lot of great businesses, shut their doors, and it was just like one after another. It was like a domino effect, and it got to a point where that was like kind of like a ghost town.
Victor Montez has run his food truck, Vic's Grill, off Gordon Highway for years. He's seen the area decline, but he's seen the new plans, too.
The interior of the mall being opened up, creating more natural light to make it feel like you're actually just walking down a street in the middle of this building.
Local architects and Regency's owners came up with a plan to take the old mall and revive it into a community with walking trails, apartments, even retail, and restaurant space for businesses that might want more than four wheels.
I would be interested in having one of those spots because it has always been a dream of mine.
After construction begins, they estimate it'll take 2 years to complete.
The great thing about it, with it being multiple buildings, it can be phased.
The goal is not only to revitalize Regency, but to breathe life into South Augusta.
I hope that everything, you know, pulls together.
So far, the estimated cost of this project is anywhere between $100 and $175 million. So far, the owners will be responsible for footing that bill. Reporting from Regency, Kennedy Harris, on your side.
Pretty wild. Can't wait to see what happens. But the Economic Development Authority says the plans are already submitted to planning and zoning for their approval. That process takes 6 to 8 weeks. Then it's up to commission to approve it and the owners to start construction. But we will, of course, keep you posted. And if you want to weigh in on the plans yourself, there's a town hall about it on Monday. Candidate for Mayor Stephen Kendrick and some other city officials will be at Diamond Lakes Community Center to answer your questions. Starts at 6 o'clock. They'll have another public session at Henry Brigham Community Center on Wednesday.
In Aiken, city officials are asking you to come out and give your thoughts on another big project, Project Pascalis. This plan includes redeveloping parts of Newberry Street right there in the heart of the city. Officials also want to tear down and replace the old Aiken Hotel. In its place, you can see new retail space, apartments, and even a parking garage. This meeting is coming up Tuesday, Newberry Hall, downtown Aiken, from 5 until 7. If you can't make it out, they are going to live stream this event, and we will have a link to watch that on our website after that meeting is complete. So I think they'll record that instead of live stream.
Happening in less than an hour, the Eric J. Smalls Memorial Banquet gets underway at AU Somerville campus. A high school senior going to college with plans to play basketball will get a $1,000 scholarship in Eric's name. Eric was just 9 years old when he died in a car accident with two other young children back in 2015. The other two kids were 8-year-old John Powell and 9-year-old Quamaine Jones. Tonight's memorial banquet starts at 7 o'clock. It's in the Jaguar Student Activity Center Ballroom. New today, the Barnwell County Sheriff's Office says many were left scared and shaken after a shooting at a graduation party Tuesday. Deputies say when they got to the scene, they found several victims terrified and some hurt. They say multiple cars were destroyed by bullets. It happened Tuesday in the area of Union Circle Incline during that graduation party. To help the victims, the Sheriff's Office is partnering with the Aiken Barnwell Mental Health Center for a community support event. It's from 10 to 1:30 tomorrow at the Access Center on Fuldner Road. If you want counseling over the phone, you can also get that. You can call 803-541-7913 if you need help. If you know anything about who was involved in that shooting, call the Sheriff's Office.
New in the last couple of hours, the Aiken County Sheriff's Office says they're investigating a shooting on Summerhill Avenue. Deputies say at least one person has been injured there. That call came coming in just before 4:30. These are photos of that road taped off and deputies on the scene sent to us by a viewer. We're still working to find how serious those injuries are. Anthony?
All right, as we continue on through this evening, we're keeping an eye online.
Anthony?
All right, as we continue on through this evening, we're keeping an eye on a line of showers and storms developing just to the west of the CSRA. They could be pushing through the CSRA later on this evening, and more storms possible for tomorrow afternoon. We'll break down the timeline of it all coming up next.
And it is your health. It's only going to be as good as you make an effort to maintain that. Why being proactive over reactive is the key to men's health. Coming up.
Middle of next week.
One thing most doctors agree on is that preventative screenings and doctor's visits can make all the difference in your health.
But it seems men have an issue. A new national study shows nearly 60% of us don't regularly see a doctor. Claire Allen heard from some local groups who want more men to get more proactive.
Medical Associates Plus will host the CSRA's first male-focused health expo here at Bernie Ward Community Center. The health center says this event would be a blessing to many men.
Men don't seem to realize that their health matters too. They do everything but take care of their health.
Data from the Cleveland Clinic found only 3 in 5 men get annual checkups. MAP here in Augusta tells us 80% of the people they see are women and only 20% are men. They are looking to change those numbers.
We want to connect men with health care.
The theme for the health fair is Men Matter Too. Doctors want you to know even if you feel good, something still can be wrong.
The top conditions for men are cardiovascular disease, cancer, COPD, pneumonia, flu, diabetes, suicide, kidney disease, chronic liver disease, and cirrhosis.
The expo will give blood pressure, blood sugar, and cancer screenings, along with COVID testing and vaccines. Men can also get a food voucher from local farmers.
So there's a lot of things that we can prevent by jumping on it early with that preventive care.
Doctors are hoping to break the stigmas surrounding men in healthcare.
So part of it is cultural, you know, it's like how people are raised. Part of it is there's a stigma to seek help. Part of it is when you're thinking about what you want to make time for, I think men think, I need to make time to make money or take care of the family, and they just put themselves last.
Now at the fair, men will also be able to schedule appointments for follow-up care. Reporting in South Augusta, Claire Allen, On Your Side.
Claire, thanks for that. Men Matter 2 is coming up this Saturday from 10 until 2 over at the Bernie Ward Community Center. It's free. It's open to all men who need to take care of themselves. If you can't make Saturday's event, AU is hosting a free health fair the following Saturday. Scan that QR code on your screen and you can register for that, or you can register at the Warren Road Community Center the day of the event. They're going to have screenings for men's and women's health, plus mental health services on site. It goes on from 9 until noon. To sports now, the coaching carousel continues in high school basketball, plus a local baseball player named an All-American. It's all ahead next with Nick.
And more high school graduates are skipping the books and heading for a paycheck after turning the tassel. A look at our local student trends after the break.
The Limelight. Our First Alert commitment to you is now 5 meteorologists, all the tools, the latest technology, and the largest team of 5 meteorologists. News 12, NBC 26, First Alert Weather, on your side. On Your Sideline, sports brought to you by the Hawk Law Group.
We often talk about the coaching carousel in sports, and we're starting to see it here locally in our high school ranks as well. Josie girls basketball coach Juwan Bailey left for Newton a few weeks back, and now another big girls basketball coach is moving on. Grovetown's George Dukes is leaving the Warriors and taking the women's head coaching basketball job at USC Salcahatchie. Dukes had been with the Warriors for 3 years, winning a pair of region titles and making a trip to the Elite Eight in 2021. I spoke with Dukes on the phone, and he said coaching college basketball has always been a dream of his. He said it was tough breaking the news to his team, but he's excited for this new opportunity. Since he's leaving at kind of a weird time, he says he'll be bouncing back and forth between Salcahatchie and Grovetown to make sure both programs run smoothly until Grovetown can get settled. He made sure to shout out his extremely supportive wife as he does all that traveling this summer. In other coaching news, Augusta Men's Golf has their new lead man, Stephen Payne, takes over the program as the 7th head coach in history. Payne has spent the last couple years as an assistant in the Mississippi State program. He's also got head coaching experience at Point University. Payne takes over for Jack O'Keefe, who stepped down after this past season. Finally this evening, former Greenbrier baseball player Chase Dollander is now named an All-American. Dollander is leading the top-seeded Tennessee Vols in the NCAA tournament. He also won SEC Pitcher of the Year this season.
Nick, thanks. The National Research Center says enrollment at colleges and universities was down nearly 5% this spring compared to the last year. Even graduate and professional student enrollment dipping some, but not quite as dramatic, down at 1%. At our local schools, it's a similar story with enrollment dropping at both the AU and USCA.
This week, AU President Brooks Keel says the school hopes to rebound and have enrollment numbers go up year over year. Our Alyssa Lyons joins us now live outside of AU. And Alyssa, you've spoken to both universities. So what are they saying about trying to get more students through those doors?
Yeah, absolutely. They are still stemming from the pandemic. And despite those numbers, they're still trying to get those students back into the classroom. And it can be felt, like you said, right here at home.
It's the same story from USC Aiken.
I've been doing this for more than 30 years, and those were definitely challenging years.
To Augusta University, AU's Vice President of Enrollment says the Jack saw a 3% drop in undergraduate enrollment from fall 2020 to 2021. This school year, she's also noticed a 12% hit in the undergrad nursing program.
There were just some challenges, I think, for all of us, whether those be mental health challenges, whether those be challenges with just feeling comfortable coming to class.
Across the river, they're also seeing empty desks.
So we were just short of 4,000 overall students right before the pandemic. We only slipped 50 students or something during the pandemic. It wasn't, but we were growing every year before that.
And once colleges get the students in the door, it's even harder keeping them. Augusta University's current retention rate sits about 70%.
You see the larger percentage of students would leave after their first year. Once they stayed their second year or their third year, they probably found that sense of belongingness and are more interested in staying. They found their place. They found their major. They feel very committed to their degree and their program pathway.
Now, despite those changes in enrollment, Augusta University says it's not going to hinder any future development plans here. But just looking at preliminary numbers and those students registering for classes, they're starting to see those numbers creep back up.
All right, thank you for that, Alyssa. As we continue on through the next couple days, we're going to keep an eye on potential cyclone number 1 in the Gulf of Mexico. We'll give you the latest track coming up next.